Hi everyone, welcome back to another YouTube video. In today's video, we're going to do something different. I'm actually starting a new series where I'm going to invite industry professionals from the industry and basically ask them questions. And I thought it would be a good idea for all of you to hear from like different industry professionals in addition to watching my videos. So like I'm starting this series today. We have an amazing guest. His name is Dan Lee. He's an ex-Google, ex-PayPal, amazing, brilliant data scientist. So he's joining us today and we're gonna basically learn about his journey and his experience working at these big tech companies and also get to know about what he's up to now. Like, what do you do after working at such big tech companies? Like, what's next? I'm really excited to talk to Dan today. So before we jump into it, make sure to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you wanna hear more about data science, tech lifestyle, career, and the new series which we're starting today. I don't know what I'm gonna call it. Like, you tell me, what should I call it? Like, give me a name. Without wasting any more time, Dan, welcome to my YouTube channel. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Hey, thanks, Sundas, and to all the viewers out there. Definitely got the description correct, except for the brilliant part. I don't think I'm that brilliant. Rather, I'm just a hard worker. My name is Dan Lee. I've been a data scientist for about 5 years. I worked in various sort of kind of lines of businesses. So I was a consultant data science at Booz Allen Hamilton for the first 2 years after college graduation with a degree in statistics in 2016. Did that for about 2 years, did some pretty cool stuff. Like I did some consultation for the US Marines. We were trying to understand like, you know, the behaviors of suicide and what are the driving factors and those sort of things. And then, you know, 2018 kind of came about and then I got my taste of, you know what, like I really want to break into tech. So I applied a bunch of places and then there was like a startup that was really interested in my profile and then moved to Palo Alto 2018. And then a couple months later, the startup got acquired by PayPal and then I made my transition over to PayPal. Did that for almost 2 years and then eventually I made my way over to my dream company.
Wow, awesome. So let me ask you this. Let's go back a little bit. I was just going through your LinkedIn. So did you always knew that you wanted to get into data science? It seems like you have a degree in statistics. So like, what was that? What was the reasoning behind that?
No. Yeah. So I was so undecided when I entered college. You know, I once sort of picked up this funny joke, you know, I'm Korean American, but it's like, if you're like Asian, like you're either like a lawyer or you're a doctor or you're a loser sort of thing. Like, to be honest, like that was the sort of like mentality I had. Like a lot of my friends are Koreans. And so they're like, yeah, I'm either going to be one of those two. Definitely not the third, you know? So I was pursuing like creative writing as a major. Definitely did not think about anything technical at this point. So this is like my, I'd say like second year in college. But then one of the courses I needed to take was intro to statistics. So I took that course and then I had a fabulous professor. Shout out to Dr. Lemons out there. You know, Dr. Lemons, if he's listening to this, you know, I made like a pivot to pursuing statistics as my studies. And then, you know, and then the rest is history. And then my first job being a consultant at Booz Allen Hamilton. And then from there, that kind of felt like a stepping stone.
You know, I had like a similar experience where I had that amazing professor for finance. And I took his class and I loved it. I was like, I want to go into finance. I almost majored into finance until I took another class. And then I got introduced to the data field. And I'm like, okay, yeah, this is way, way more interesting than finance. So it's amazing, yeah. Like how much school and different teachers, different classes can have a big impact on our career. What are some things that you enjoyed about data science? And what are some things that you wish that could get better?
Yeah, so yeah. Starting with the first question, I mean, what are things I enjoy about data science? I mean, there's definitely so many. I would say like what really intrigued me about data science from the get-go is like the fact that you have an interesting question to begin with, right? Like an interesting question that is actionable in many sense. And, you know, you're given this haystack representing data, messy data, right? And then you try to find a particular signal with this haystack. And then you present this pitch to your business stakeholders, be like, yeah, this is what the data says, you know, and so therefore we should go about making this decision. There was something very like intriguing about this process, like here's what the data says, was very like interesting to me. And I sort of found myself kind of thinking about, you know what, like this is what I want to do.
You touch on a very good point in terms of like pretty much like all of the data science, it's very ambiguous space. Like you start with a question like, but you're not sure like where you're going to end up. I think like that's the part where they say like it's the sexiest job to some extent, right? That like there is a lot of like unknown and you don't know like what you're going to end up finding when you look at the data. One of my favorite aspects is also like the storytelling part, the decision-making part, because I feel like if you do it right, you can like truly influence how the business, how the organization runs. Going back to my second part of the question, like what are some things that were not your favorite, specifically working as a data scientist, or things that you wish that would get better over time as the industry makes progress?
Like I've often been in this sort of situation where, you know, like client might have some data, and so therefore they're immediately thinking, okay, we need a data scientist for this sort of thing, you know? Like I've been in a type of project where really the main focus of the project was just simply data transfer. Okay, we're gonna transfer this data from this old legacy system to this new system, right? And somehow along this way, when this is the primary goal of this project, right? Some client thought, hey, you know what? This is a great opportunity to bring in a data scientist and see what's inside of the data and then help us figure out something that's magical. But it's a very vague thing. Stakeholder had some sense that, you know what, like, data, like applying data scientists and data is a hot thing to do. We don't know exactly what we need, what our focus is, but let's go ahead, you know, just toss them in that situation and see what we find, right? Usually in real life, like there's no like one stakeholder, right? Like stakeholder themselves report to some other stakeholders and stuff like that, right? So just because you did something cool, like, you know, you have this data and like you plug into some, I don't know, like unsupervised algorithm, you find all these different clusters and whatnot, and you're like, hey, here's a cool story, right? Unless the stakeholder themselves just, first of all, have some sense about what they're going to do with it, it's meaningless. And the thing is that even if they find it interesting, they often don't have the resource to act on it, you know? Because it's not the primary goal of the project. And so situations like that, I would say, are definitely something that I'm not fond of when there's quite a bit of ambiguity from the get-go. And this is where, like, you know, data scientists need to do a better job in terms of, you know, don't just jump into a project because it's interesting. And more often than not, you know, stakeholders will say, this is a big opportunity. Almost every stakeholder will say that, right? You know, but you know, make some judgment, right? Like, you know, sometimes there's an opportunity cost to committing to a project. And so do a better job in screening what project is actually worthwhile versus what project isn't. Because not all projects, just because you get some experience out of it, doesn't mean that it's going to have an actual impact.
Like people love buzzwords. And it all comes down to like people not understanding like what data science actually is. Some people are just like chasing after like buzzwords. They don't understand it fully. And then they want a data scientist to do something when it's not technically like a data science work. On the other hand, like I've had cases, very like data science focused problem, but then the client is like, no, like I don't want a data scientist. I think like there's like both extreme ends to it where people don't fully understand like where exactly to evangelize a data scientist. That would get better with time, like as we make progress in the industry. But I think that's like something that everybody deals with in the data science domain. So thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
So my next question for you, I think we have touched on it briefly, like you have been at Google, you have been at PayPal. So would you be able to share with people, like what has your experience been working at those companies? Like what were some things that you found different or similar?
Let me just kind of start off in terms of my experience at PayPal. So at PayPal, I did something that was already something that I've already done when I worked at the startup, because eventually PayPal acquired that startup. And by the way, the startup name is called Simility. My specialization within data science at the time was fraud detection. So we were servicing e-commerce banks, you know, preventing like spams and like bad actors, and also banks as well. I was building models to prevent fraudulent credit card applications. It was a very kind of really like specialized in like fraud. You know, as much as it was pretty cool to like look at all these different patterns of like, you know, because you can kind of look at it in terms of like a social network. Like, so imagine you have this like network of all these different nodes of like IP addresses and device IDs and stuff like that. And then you see that there's like a fraudulent user, and turns out that this person is connected to another IP address. And then through this association, there's this email address, you know, that is, you know, fraudulent user, right? So it's pretty cool to kind of look into that data and then build like models out of it, right? But at the same time, it got fairly redundant in a sense that like you can kind of pretty much take the same framework, you know, replicate it for the next project, right? I just couldn't see myself kind of doing this sort of long term, where I'm just building one fraud model after another fraud model. And of course, like there are somewhat subtleties, you know, among fraud problems themselves, right? And people who do this, like I met people who've done it for like 10 plus years, and they love it, you know. But for me, like me being a little bit too ADHD, sort of like going back to my college days where I just keep changing my major, you know, like every 1 to 2 semesters, I felt that there was more to data science that I wanted to explore outside of just specializing in fraud. I wasn't even thinking about it at this time, but like I got a direct email from a Google recruiter in summer of 2019. And I was like pretty surprised, because I'm like, yeah, I didn't apply for this. So did they mistakenly like send an email to me? Or I don't know, you know? Because like,
do you know where they found your emails? Like, do you have any idea?
Yeah, so what I found out was that, so in the beginning of that year, I had actually applied for a YouTube data science role, you know, but that immediately, like I got rejection email, right? And so like I wasn't even thinking about it, right? Wow. And all of a sudden I get this email. And they're like, yeah, we're building out this new team within Google Finance, and we'd like for you to you know, come on interview, right? So like, this is like my golden ticket outside of fraud, and like explore different avenues within data science. And so, you know, went through the interview process and then got in, and then turns out that just because I was, you know, part of the finance team doesn't necessarily mean that the only type of data I end up working with is finance data. You know, I ended up doing all kinds of projects, from like anomaly detection system to time series forecasting. When you're in Google, you could also do like a 20% project. So this is this is something you're familiar with, right? So that's because you're also a Googler. So this 20% project is basically additional project that you can take up. And it can come from any teams, any other teams outside of your primary team. And basically you do it outside of your full-time project. And that's how I got my exposure to like product data science as well. Like I was doing A/B experiments for this team. This was like my gateway to getting different exposures to all these different projects. And so like I'd say like within PayPal it was very sort of specialized. But then when I entered Google, this is when it kind of broadened me up. And,
Awesome. Definitely. Cool. So I'm going to ask you this fun question. When you were at Google, because I know like I have my favorite perks, like what was your favorite Google perk? And you can't say food, because food is everybody's favorite perk.
A little bit cliche, but when I was at Google, I definitely used Napping Pod quite a bit.
What was just that?
The Napping Pod.
The Napping Pod. Oh, okay.
I used that quite a bit. Like I was pretty much using it like almost every day.
Every day?
Almost every day, yeah. Because the thing is, like, I'm a huge proponent of power naps, you know. I'm like even to this day, sometimes I take, like, you know, 20-minute cat naps, you know, in the afternoon.
Wow.
Because, like, my afternoon slump kicks in, like, pretty hardcore, like, usually around 1 or 2 p.m. And so, like, I need that reset. And so, for me, like, I definitely need to take a nap. And so, yeah, and also, like, you know, I live in San Francisco, and the Google office was all the way down in Sunnyvale. That's where the finance team was located. And so that long commute, like early in the morning, and then getting there, and then sometimes like I get like 4 or 5 hours of sleep because I'm naturally nocturnal.
Yeah.
I gotta catch up on sleep. And so like that was something that I definitely fully took advantage of.
You know, I'm really jealous of you because I just can't sleep like during the day. If I sleep, like I'm knocked out for a few hours, like I can't get up. Only time I did like power naps when I was in school. It's amazing that you can do that. And you actually made use of like those nap pods, because I always see them like, but I've never used it. Tell us like what you're doing now. Like you have had like an amazing career working at like big tech companies. Like what are you up to now? Like what are you doing now?
You might have kind of stumbled upon some of my content out there through LinkedIn or YouTube, something like that. But I run a business called Data Interview. Website is dataintview.com. It is basically an interview prep site for those who are preparing for data scientists, you know, data engineering, machine learning engineer interviews. And I provide courses with A/B testing, business cases, product SQL, and so forth, along with coaching services that are designed to help you prepare for these interviews. I created this from my own personal experience being a candidate multiple times. And I realized that, the process of trying to, first of all, find resources that are going to be helpful for these interviews were often very frustrating. And so I decided that, I'm going to create something where I wish I had.
I actually did a video on this recently too, talking about how the whole job search process is kind of not favored at all. Just thinking about it gives me anxiety because the data science field is so huge. And there's so many things that you can end up getting in an interview setting. So I think something like this is much needed. No. I think you touched on it a little bit, but one of the areas that I am personally super, super passionate about is the content creation. And I know you create content on LinkedIn and you're also on YouTube. What inspired you to create content and what keeps you going? Personally, what I have experienced, I am on Instagram quite a bit. I share a lot of short videos, reels, as well as on YouTube. And it's very time consuming. It's a lot of work. And sometimes you don't feel like you are rewarded for your work. So what is your process? How have you been able to kind of keep yourself motivated and inspired enough to keep creating?
Yeah. That's a really good question. It's something that I always kind of think about, right? Because prior to running this business, I didn't think too much about being an influencer in a sense. I didn't think too much about engagement. I'm I just need to create a kick-ass product and then people are going to follow me, right?
Yeah.
The word of mouth, right? But then there's more to this. There's an art to this. You have to think about, when you're putting out a message, you have to think about, each sentence, you have to sort of scrutinize, what are you trying to convey here? What is the goal, right? Who's your audience, right? It's sort of funny because this is something that we would have learned. We obviously learned when we're, writing essays, right? One of the first things is who's your audience, right? That's a very important thing to think about in real life as well. Whenever you're writing these LinkedIn posts or when you're creating YouTube videos and stuff like that. For me, I always think about my audience, right? My followers and try to kind of think about, okay, it's not so much about what is the content I need to put out in order to impress them? But what is the content I need to provide in order to give them value, right? And so that's my main North Star for me. And I don't try to think too much about whether I'm getting so much engagement back. Because if that's what I focus too much on, then I can't.
Yeah,
see.
Exactly.
That's volatile. Yeah. You know what I mean? Sometimes you might have put in a very brief effort on some LinkedIn post.
Exactly.
It blows up. In some situations, you do a lot of effort, and then you get low engagement. And so now, I just don't think too much about it. It's just okay, I wake up, and then as I kind of walk around the neighborhood in the morning, I sort of think, hey, you know what? I think this is a pretty cool content idea. So I just write out a post, in 20 minutes or less, and then I just ship it out.
That's a very important part because, I think I also got caught up in that where I was my every post of mine, every video of mine has to be super successful. If one video gets less views, and then I'm oh my gosh, I really suck. But at the end of the day, not all of your content is going to be hit.
Yeah.
There is obviously going to be some averages and some below averages. And some are going to be very few of them are going to be super hits. Getting that around wrapped around my head, I think that was very, very important to keep my own mental sanity and to be keep producing these content. So thanks for sharing that. So you are on LinkedIn.
Yeah.
You create content on LinkedIn and YouTube. These are the only two platforms you're on? Okay. Okay. Awesome.
Yes.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for joining today. And everybody, check out thedatainterview.com. I'll link it in the description below. Thank you so much for joining. I hope this was fun. I definitely learned a lot about your experience and working in the data science domain as well as working in big tech and now working as an entrepreneur. It's amazing. So thank you for coming and thank you for sharing your story. Thank you so much for joining today. I hope this video was useful. If you want me to do more of these interview style videos, and if you want me to invite certain people to my channel, let me know in the comments. And also let me know if you like this, what did you find interesting in today's conversation? What resonated with you and what you're taking away from this video? With that, thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a beautiful day and I'll talk to you later. Bye.